Over 20 years, football hooligans plagued Britain. Pitch battles between rival gangs blighted the national game and caused terror across the country.
They want to win, and if they can't win on the pitch, you know, in them days, the fans decide they'll win off the pitch, you know?
It's almost like miniature armies going to war on each other.
The odd thing is, if you weren't part of it, you were the odd one out.
I love it. I love it. You can't stop it. I suppose it's like a drug in some respects.
For the hooligans who took part, this was more than just Saturday violence. It was their culture. It was their reason for living. This is their story.
The government's emergency power restrictions
say that 1970s Britain, industrial friction, the 3-day week, power cuts, and football.
Football was the only thing that you could go to with your mates. There was nothing else, you know. There was nothing going on.
Well, a young man ain't got nothing in the world these days.
Just part and part growing up. The thing that you did on a Saturday.
I said a young man ain't got nothing in the world these days.
You have this great feeling of something happening, being adventure. I think most kids that was into football, sporting teams, if you could go back in time, you just go straight into their bedroom. It'd be a wall of scarves, but they'd all be scarves from different teams. I mean, it was a great big thing when they come out with satin scarves and. Yeah, they said nick them off away fans, another trifle on the bedroom light. It was totally antisocial behaviour.
And it seems now might well be...
Antisocial behaviour and football went hand in hand. It was nothing new. End-of-season pitch invasions, the odd Derby Day riot. Local fights for local people. But in the early 70s, the soccer thugs were on the move. Every Saturday, towns and cities across Britain barricaded their doors and windows against the invading hooligan armies. And one of the key causes of this nationwide explosion of violence was the train, specifically the football specials.
Specials were things that British Rail put on, slightly cheaper rates, so that they would bring down perhaps 1,000 fans. They never put new trains on. They only ever put their old tat. They were just filthy. The toilets were never working. The cleaners used to have a hell of a job clearing up urine, faeces. They were just terrible.
Cold. Normally they had no eating on them, no food or drink on them. You'd have in them days, probably a 6-hour journey up to somewhere like Newcastle. No facilities on them. All the toilets were overflowing. You were basically treated like cattle.
It was nearly always guards vans, and they had the cage. You'd be standing in this cage, looking through the slats in the wood. It was ridiculous.
With the introduction of the British Rail football specials, the number of travelling fans increased from just a handful to thousands every match day. This was the start of decades of grief and overtime for the small and rather unprepared band of British Transport Police.
When I first joined, my very first football season, we had to share equipment. I had the truncheon, my friend had the handcuffs, somebody else had a whistle.
We've got these search balls.
Radios didn't work underground. On trains, they didn't work. Equipment was terrible. It was literally Dixon and Doc Green. 5 or 6 bobbies in raincoats and scarves and hats.
Transport police were trying to come to terms with the sheer numbers of fans on the football specials. A whole new world was opening up for the 70s hooligan.
When you are 19 or 20, you just feel completely invincible. You feel like you can take the whole world on, you know. First stop Rochdale, next stop the world. Just move on up
toward your destination. I still remember going to places, New York, and they're boarding it up. You know, they've got the hammer and nails out and they're up at the windows there. And, you know, you think the Vikings was coming. You wouldn't think it was just a set of football fans, but probably that's how they saw United fans in them days, because they probably did act like Vikings, apart from the rape and the pillage. Well, not so much the rape, the pillage. And take
the trip. They get a look of bewilderment from the shoppers there, thinking, who are this gang all dressed the same with Crombie overcoats on and state breasts and... You know, we always fought in London. We was ahead of the Northerners in the fashion stakes. So we'd turn up, you know, like peacocks posing in their town, going through the town centre.
I was asked to shut. I was told by the police this would be the best proposition.
What sort of things have happened to people who work and live around here in the past?
How do you mean, like?
Well, has there been trouble in the past around
here? Oh, yes, there's been loads of trouble. I mean, we've had as much as £100-odd worth of damage done in the shop.
Now, why football fans should take it out on property? It's beyond me. I mean, there's having a laugh with lads, having a rumble with lads, but smashing up people's property, you know, it's not my kind, it's not my idea of fun.
You're walking around a northern town and you're not really familiar with these places, and dare I say a lot of these places are always very dark and very grey. That in itself put trepidation into you.
Going away might have been an adventure, but it also had its dangers.
I remember going to Sheffield United as a young boy, and I fell for the oldest trick in the book. Somebody asked me the time, looked at my watch, got a fist in the face, and then we were chased by a marauding pack of Sheffield United fans, all half rabid and half mad.
Visiting hooligans quickly learnt the lessons of invasion. In this weird and brutal world, a pattern of behaviour began to emerge. A routine with a number of simple rules. Do anything
you wanna do! You'd stick with your mates. If a fight did break out, they would stand with you, they wouldn't run away and leave you. Do anything
you wanna do! Make sure you get your blows in first, because if someone knocks you between the face, then you've got no chance of getting up again. Do anything
you wanna do! It's a special kind of bottle you need. It's a face 100 lads running at your screen, chucking bottles. It's a different kind of bottle you need.
If you're looking for a fight, then you've got to make sure you actually stand up. It's no good having people that run away.
We call it melting, but if it was coming on top that you were getting battered, then a lot of people would just melt away.
The other thing, of course, to make sure is that our friends from the police are not around.
Hotspur fans rioted through villages in Bedfordshire last
Millwall
night.
Millwall fans did £45,000 worth of damage in 30 minutes of violence.
In the mid-70s, vandalism on the football specials was almost a weekly event, commonly running into thousands of pounds worth of damage.
The specials were the ones we had trouble with. We did have windows smashed, especially if it went through a station where there were rival fans travelling another way and they were waiting for a train. They would sometimes get the windows put in. We did have carriages set on fire once, and a train got burnt out. Criminal damage to the trains was mainly sporadic. It wasn't well organised, not in the 70s anyway. Mainly drink-induced.
After a day of terror on the terraces and on the streets, football's hooligan army travelled back home, fuelled by alcohol and tales of fistfights in far-flung towns.